I hope you are going to present a talk or going to use the effect of the water drinking test. Colonel Alok Sati was given the talk on diurnal variation, but the army has an unpredictability and he has been involved with the, with some important assignment in the armed forces. So this is also now, I like to cover on the diurnal variation test. And about the diurnal variation test, because of the lack of facilities, the office diurnal variation has been promoted by most of us. So let's see whether is it worth to consider or it needs some additional input with the 24-hour diurnal variation. Then the factor of stress strain, when you are calling somebody in the your clinic and he's sitting for longer period, how to get rid of these pressures. So these are the burning aspects of it. And higher IOP, is, as we all know, is a risk factor for the occurrence and progression of glaucoma. There are the different patterns which we have, the two standard deviations above and below mean IOP, if it is 10 to 21. 50% of individuals in general population having glaucomatous optic neuropathy and or visual field loss have initial screening of IOPs below 22 millimeter of mercury. We all talk about glaucoma, the intraocular pressure, but it's not only the intraocular pressure. Intraocular pressure is a outcome of a certain inherent disease process. So it's a vascular phenomena. Leading with the any kind of a vascular disease, you will have all changes. So when you are measuring the intraocular pressure for longer period, you have to see that how the other systems of the coronaries and all others are working, because glaucoma is a part of a vasculopathies only. That is why we have to keep on lowering the target pressure from 50 to 80, 1 to 2 millimeter every decade. Now, office-based tonometry in which only a snapshot of the patient's pressure is recorded and peak IOP level are missed in up to the 62% of the patients. My own observations in a day pressure with my own colleague, ophthalmologist, senior ophthalmology administrators, coming with the congested eyes, little this, some say allergies and all those, corneal thickness is fine, pressure is fine, we suggested we'll have a record a pressure. They said, no, I have no time. Take five times in my office during daytime. We did it, it was all fine. Again, this problem was not solved. I said, no, now for one night, I will be in your bedroom, not the other person. And I'll be taking pressure 2 to 3 hourly. I did it to my commandant in FMC Pune. And at 2 o'clock, I found his pressure was going 40. So it happens. One of my senior colleague in Kolkata, ophthalmologist, myopics, his pressure used to be around 10, 12, but he had almost 90% cupping. And a night pressure between 12 to 4, it was touching 25, 30. So that is very, very glaring that it's so important to not only to diagnose, but to check the further how it is going to take place. As I mentioned, it has a direct fluctuation. This is called, some say there are two peaks, some has a one peak, but it is varying with the person's own personality. As it's a not only the physiological problems, but it is a mental trait also, which is coming here. Now see here that in 1898, it was first measured in 1904. The gentleman was the first ophthalmologist to quantitate the daily fluctuations in IOP. So there are things are keep on going there. These are the various curves which we have. That rising type maximum at 4 to 6 p.m. All these are the Western literatures. Your literature in the Indian population will be varying. In the North India will be varying from the South India. With the corneal thickness, refractive status, and so many factors are there. It's so compound phenomena which cannot be. And flat type with the no variations, probably very few people will be coming in that bracket. Incidentally, how many ophthalmologists have undergone their intraocular pressure recording regularly, fields? we don't do it. That's our mistake. And then we can't think of doing that, how this diurnal variation will take place. I believe in one thing as the most favorite guinea pig for me of any treatment in investigative procedure is myself. I have used all ophthalmic medicine in my eye, including atropine, before prescribing to the patient. And I have carried out this test on me also. So lighter part of it, when you are going for the water drinking test, take care of the prostate. But yes, this gives these things, and every one of us has this tendency to go. If you are in a severe stress, your water drinking, diurnal, all will give the peaks there. These are the factors associated with elevation and reduction of intraocular pressure. Supine position, then Vosalva maneuver, and all is known, pregnancy, metabolic acidosis. So again, you have the diabetic status. Corticosteroid treatment, general anesthetics except ketamine, obviously that is a pathological situation. So IOP is the only known modifiable factor that has been shown to delay progression of disease in both ocular hypertensive and glaucoma patients. So you have a diurnal variation for detection, you have a diurnal variation for the see the progression also, particularly on the normal tension glaucoma patients. Earlier dictum was that then when you have to do the diurnal variation, stop all medications for fortnight and then do it. I don't believe in that, because if the patient is already on the medicine, his pressure, now we have to see with this type of the medication, how he is maintaining throughout the day, including 24 hours. So we have conducted a dissertation on this. We compare the diurnal variation with medicines and withdrawing the medicines. And obviously you were getting much more information when you have the medicines on with this particular in situations. And those who have read Duke Elder probably, they will enjoy these writings that what has been reported about the high intraocular pressure. And others also suggested the IOP could increase dramatically when the subjects were asleep. So deep sleep is also a problem, and less sleep is also a problem. Deep sleep apnea, my other colleagues will cover, that can create nuisance. And if you are not sleeping, stress, and you have a mixed angle type, there is no compartment like open angle and the angle closer. There is always a, you can find in an open angle, there is a angle closer and vice versa. Both pathologies are going on. Like in pseudophakic eye, you may have an angle closer. It has been seen by us in gonioscopy. So these are the various studies which has shown then how the intraocular pressure is varying with the time, and you see that these depending upon the peak patterns. The difference in the type of tonometers, age, race, and the ocular conditions of subjects might be responsible for variability of the result. So the titration is very important. Goldman applanation tonometer is considered as a golden yardstick. It's true to some extent when you compare with the NCTs and all others, but Goldman also can lead to a fluctuations in the reading these predictabilities. With the film thickness, etc., and then the lid position, eye is slightly down, astigmatism. So when you are doing, I prefer myself personally to do it rather than blaming my resident for corneal aberrations, etc. As much as possible, we try to do ourselves, or we standardize them with our this pressure readings, so how it is coming. So these are the various methods which have been used. We have used eye care, we have used applanation, and eye care is fairly reliable. It's, the result wise, it is very stable, and you are not using any dye, your prism is not touching. So if you have access to eye care, probably it is equally good as it is an applanation tonometer is there. Now, fluctuation IOP is difficult to measure in certain conditions, as I have mentioned here. I have another talk also. I'll continue both these things in the same manner. These are the various reports. So I come to the important clinical implication for glaucoma patients. Large diurnal variation is a risk factor for progression of glaucoma. IOP peaks over certain level or diurnal range above certain level in the absence of visual field loss or glaucometer scuffing might be indicative of ocular hypertension. This word ocular hypertension is too much foxing to me. I yet to decide to whom to label ocular hypertensive and not to treat, and the other person who is just borderline not coming in the higher range to treat or not to treat. That dilemma I yet to decode in our situations. So as I mentioned, the single office measurement of IOP do not adequately depict the degree of fluctuation of IOP. Best way to monitor IOP to measure in the 24-hour changes in the IOPs of hospitalized patients. And if you have the online type, if you are providing or going in the same environment, probably you may be having the more reliable. Regarding your the daytime and morning for the water drinking has given a beautiful idea to us, and we will definitely conduct the study on that and will come out with this. Anything you'd like to add on water, this diurnal variation?
Thank you very much for a very nice talk. Actually, with as you say, eye care is actually a good screening tool, and eye care are coming up with a new gadget which we can actually give it to the patient to take home. So some of the good advanced glaucoma clinics, so they train, but we can't do it with every patient. Patient has to be intelligent one. So we give them eye care to take home, and then take the pressure, and all those readings are automatically come into iPhones. And that is also a way of testing.
I tried myself, and I take my own intraocular pressure with eye care myself.
Yes, thank you.
It can be done. Only thing there, your orbicularis should not be